Hello, in this tutorial we're going to be doing per pixel collision detection on rotated sprites. Very interesting stuff. Let's start by creating a new project. This is tutorial 19. First thing we want to do, of course, is add our content to the solution. That's three items: the bullet, enemy one, and player. Once those three items have been added, let's build the content, obviously. Let's create four classes. We'll create the component class, which we usually have, then four sprite classes. Obviously, that's sprite, ship, and then bullet. Once those classes have been created, we need to go paste in some basic stuff that we've already had before, or maybe not had before. Start off with the component class. I'll paste in the update and draw method, then include the usings. Next, if we paste in the sprite class, this is a general sprite class I've been using throughout my tutorials. I will explain them now. So we've got the texture, which is protected, so we can use it in any children classes. We've got the float, which is also protected, the current and previous key for our keyboard input. We've got the origin, which we're going to be using as the center of the sprite. We've got the position, which is obviously the position in the world. The rectangle, which uses the position minus the origin so that it can get the bounding box around our sprite. We obviously have then the color, the direction, the velocity of how fast it spins and how fast it goes forward. We've got the parent sprite, the lifespan of a sprite. So if it's like a bullet, for example, the is removed boolean. Then if we go down, we've got the constructor, which takes a texture, instantiates the origin, sets the color to white. We have a base update method, which doesn't do anything. We have the standard draw method, which brings all that together, and we have the object clone, which is from the iClonable up at the top. Before we move on from the sprite class, we're going to add in a new property that will be a list of sprites, and we're going to call that children. This children property will be the bullets in this instance, and we're going to be adding them in the ship class. So that's the basic sprite class. Next, we're going to be doing the bullet class. Let me paste that in. So as you can see, all we do is override the constructor and the update method. The update method, of course, just shoots the bullet and removes it once it's lived its life. Okay, so let me talk through the ship class. I have created this in a previous tutorial, but to be clear, we have the bullet property at the top, which is a sort of prefab that they use in Unity. We've got the constructor, which overrides the base constructor. The update method, which sets the previous and current key. We then check the keyboard's A and D have been pressed to set the rotation. We then figure out the direction, then check to see if we press W to move us forward. And then finally in that method, we check to see if we're pressing space. If we do, then we call the shoot method, which adds a new cloned bullet to the children list. Okay, that's it for the base stuff that we've already done in previous tutorials. Now for the actual new stuff. We're gonna add in two new properties to our sprite class. First property is a read-only color array called texture data. The texture data is gained from the texture that we'll be passing through the constructor, and I'll set that later. Next is a transform matrix, which uses the origin of our sprite, the rotation, and its position to get a transform matrix, which we can use later for the per pixel collision detection. Notice how I'm using vector3 for the translation methods. That's because the matrix works in a 3D space, but we're using the 2D at the moment. So we pass in a vector2, then a 0 for the z-axis. Next, we want to do two things in our sprite constructor. We want to instantiate the children list and then actually assign the texture data a value. So below in the constructor, when we instantiate the texture data, we give it the amount of texture width multiplied by texture height. So that's the count of the array is how many pixels are in the texture. We then call our texture.getData to assign the array to the texture data. Okay, before I get on to the per pixel collision detection method, I'm actually going to add in a virtual method called onCollide. So as you can see, it takes in a sprite parameter. That means that sprites can only collide with sprites. You can't collide with something else like a font, for example, because that would be crazy. Now I'm going to paste in the method for the per pixel collision intersects. If you don't actually want to type this all out, go look in the description. There is a link to the GitHub where you can go find this project and copy it from there. The gist of the code is we're checking the matrix of the two transform matrix to see if they're colliding. If they are colliding, we loop around the texture data, if we correctly rotate that, and seeing if both the alpha colors aren't zero. If they're not zero, then we return true, which means they're colliding. And that's how the per pixel collision works. It's very overwhelming, I guess, with the amount of code that's being used. But have a read through it, see if it makes any sense. Now we want to implement the onCollide method for the bullet. The first check we do in the onCollide is to check if the sprite we're colliding with is the parent. If it is, we just return straight out because we don't want to do anything. The second check is to see if it's a bullet. Again, we don't want to collide with other bullets, so we leave. And then finally, we'll just set is removed to true, which will remove the sprite from our list of sprites. Now to implement everything inside the game class. The only property we need is the list of sprites, which is pretty handy. In the load content, we're going to have a ship texture. We're also going to have a prefab for the bullet. And then we're going to instantiate our sprites and pass in three objects. The first object we're going to add is the ship class. This is so we have a controllable sprite passing the bullet prefab for the bullet. Set the color to green, which is nice. Once we've finished that ship class, we'll copy and paste it twice. We'll rename the type ship to sprite. We'll remove the prefab, the bullet prefab, change the position for them both, of course, and change the second sprite so that its texture is enemy underscore one. So the first sprite will be the ship texture, and the second will be enemy underscore one. And then we'll add in a semicolon there. Change that color to red. Okay, let's do our update and draw before we start getting to the complicated stuff. So there are three final steps, and this is all post-update steps. The three steps are check the collision between all the sprites, add the children sprites to the list of sprites, and then remove all is-removed sprites. So let's go create a post-update method for that. As you may remember, the post-update is something I use with my states classes, so this is to keep it consistent with that design. So like I said, the post update is to check the collision between all the current sprites, add the children from the current sprites to the sprites list, and then clear the children list, and then finally remove all is removed sprites from the sprites list. Okay, so the first thing we're going to do is the collision. We need two for each loops. The first one we're going to use in sprite A in our for each loop, and in the second one that's sprite B. First check in the second loop is if sprite A equals sprite B. We just continue, which moves on to the next iteration. That's so we don't collide with ourselves. And then the second check is to see if sprite A intersects, which is our pixel collision detection, with sprite B. If they do intersect, then we call the onCollide for our sprite B from sprite A. That will, in this instance, only do the bullet collision. So that's what we're doing here. Next, we want to do the children list to sprites. So we create a local variable called count, which is equal to sprites.count. The point of that is so we don't change our sprites count value while we're looping around our sprites. While we're in that loop, we will loop around our children, which is for each var child in sprites.children, and then we'll do sprites to add child, and after that we'll call sprites I dot children dot clear. That clears the list, which means we won't be able to add the same child twice on the next iteration. And then the final thing we've done 1,000,000,006 times before, we're going to loop around our sprites again and remove any sprite that is classed as is removed. So that will be gone by the time we get to the draw method, and it won't be here in the next iteration, which is pretty cool. So we remove our I, and then we do I minus minus so the count doesn't get mixed up. And now if we process that, we can see we've got the two sprites, which are enemies, and the green one, which is the player. He spins around and shoots. We look at that collision. It only seems to hit the colors. It goes right past if it's not touching a color, which was exactly what we was hoping to do. Huzzah! That's about it for this tutorial. Thank you for watching.